And welcome back to the channel for our second lesson on learning to read Greek by reading the actual Greek New Testament. As always, I'm going to record this is a playlist I'm sure you've seen about. I'll make sure you've seen the first video, which is the introductory video, the second video, which gets us into John 1:1. And then we're going to pause. We're not going to look at the actual Greek text here. We're going to go ahead and learn the rest of the alphabet and some pronunciation kind of guides. It will help you out quite a bit. And so let's just go ahead and get right into this. Oh, and then last little commercial, let's make sure you check out the Reader's Greek New Testament of the first 13-ish verses of Gospel of John in the video description. Check that out. That will help you out quite a bit as well in the next coming videos. So let's go ahead and get into the actual text. Not the text, the actual alphabet. Let's learn all of the letters. And so last time we kind of learned the letters kind of hodgepodge. This is the actual alphabet itself here, the Greek alphabet in the proper order. There are 24 letters total. And what I want you to notice is that you have learned more than half of them. You already know 15 letters. You know the alpha, the gamma, the epsilon, the eta, theta, iota, kappa, lambda. You know the nu, you know the omicron, you know the p, you know the rho, you know the sigma, you know the tau, and you know the chi. So this is, you've already done half of the battle here. Pretty cool, right? So what we want to do is we want to go ahead and learn the rest of, all the rest of the letters as we go through. And alpha, beta, gamma, I'll go and say them quickly all now and then tell you how the chart is set up and then we'll start looking at the individual letters. But the letters are alpha, beta, gamma, delta, epsilon, zeta, eta, theta, iota, kappa, lambda, mu. That's the next column, nu, xi, omicron, p, rho, sigma, tau, upsilon, phi, chi, psi, and omega. The way this is set up is the first column in of the two, each of the first, these first rows or first columns rather, is the capital Greek letter. The second column is the lowercase Greek letter. Now, I would spend more time focusing on the lowercase Greek letters than the uppercase. You need to know both. But the lowercase appears way, way, way more often than the uppercase, just by far more often. And so you need to have a perfect knowledge of the lowercase letters, know the uppercase, and if you have time to memorize it, great, but at least get the lowercase down pat. The third column is going to be the name of the letter written out in English letters so you can read it. And then this fourth column is kind of does double duty. It tells you what's called a transliteration. So if you ever want to write the letter out using English letters, this is the letter that letter we use. And you can also use it in many cases to kind of give you a sense for what the sound makes. Some doesn't always imply, like a theta does not say qua in the Q case, but, and you'll see some of the reasons as we go through here, why we've chosen what we have. So capital letter, lowercase letter, name of the letter, and then the transliteration. All right. And typically, by the way, when you write a transliterated Greek word, you would do the lowercase letters in italics. So that being said, let's go ahead and start getting into the individual letters. First of all, you should know that there are, as in English, vowels and consonants. It's good to know the vowels. We'll need them later on beyond the fact that there's no vowels. Anyway, the vowels consist of these seven. There's the alpha, the epsilon, the eta, the iota, the omicron, the upsilon, and the omega. Not that different from the English alphabet, English vowels, A, E, I, O, and U. They just have two extras. They have a long O and they have a long E, the eta and the omega. But outside of that, it's very much similar, very much the same. All the rest are consonants. So let me then actually at that point go ahead before we look at letters to avoid. Let me go through here and walk through each individual letter so we can kind of see. I'm going to go back so we can get the colors off the screen. I don't want to confuse you unnecessarily. This first letter, again, you know, is the alpha. Capital A is easy. The second letter is a beta. Beta is really easy. And so you have the capital B. The lowercase beta just looks like a lowercase b. And so beta is going to say b, beta. You know the gamma already. Gamma says g, gamma, with the capital gamma looking kind of like an upside down L, sort of, right? The delta is going to say d, d, delta. And it actually kind of looks like a d. It's not that confusing. It just has a little, see the D in it with the squiggle off the up to the right. And then the delta, if you take any math, you've recognized the symbol. It's just a triangle. That's the capital delta. Epsilon, again, you know, the capital E, and then lowercase looks like an E. Zeta is one, I don't know why, this one took forever for me to get, but when I look at it now, all these years later, it's obvious to me, it's just a funky looking Z, it's a fancy Z. You can see, if you look at the Zeta, it goes to the right, top right, and then the slash down left, go back to the right with a little tail off the bottom. It looks like the letter Z. And so Zeta, of course, is gonna say Z, capital Z, and there's your lowercase Zeta. Eta, you've already seen with a capital, what we call a capital H is the capital letter, there's your lowercase Eta. Theta, you already know, there's the lowercase Theta. The capital is just a capital O with the line in the middle that doesn't connect it all the way. Iota, you already know, it just looks like a lowercase I and a capital I. Kappa, you already know, looks like a lowercase K and a capital K, says K. Lambda, you already know. See the benefit of doing it this way? Lambda, there's your lowercase lambda, says L, and there is your capital lambda, looks like an upside down capital V or a triangle without the base across the bottom. Now, mu is another letter that you haven't learned yet. Again, this one might be at first confusing because it might think you look like a U, but in fact, I want to suggest it does look like an M. It says mm, as a mu should, but if you look, it looks kind of like where this circle is. Notice the tails at the bottom. This kind of looks like this could be an M there. You know, it's kind of going like that. Just a kind of a funky looking M with the capital in that way. So that's a mu. It's going to say mm. We've already talked about the nu, which is the N sound, capital N. Now, C is another one. There's really no way to get this super easy. It looks like a capital E, and then the capital letter is an I, a capital I with a line stricken through. There's no way to do this other than just to memorize this. If you think of an easy way, put it in the comments. I just had to memorize it. But C is just going to say X. Omicron, you already know. Omicron with a capital O. P, you already know. Lowercase looks like a P. It says P. There's your capital P. It looks like a, kind of think it looks like a stapler a little bit, a staple. There is your row. And to make this doubly confusing, it looks like a P. And then the capital P is what we use for the capital row. So you just have to not confuse the P and the row. And it says R. Now, sigma is worth taking a minute. You know one of these already. The sigma here with the, looks like the C with the tail on the end, I told you before, looks like an S with a kind of looking funny tail. That's a sigma. The one in the middle that looks like an O with a line across the top, the reason there are two different versions of the sigma is if it's in the middle of the word, it is going to have this version of sigma. If the sigma is at the end of the word, it's going to have this version. So in logos, because the sigma is on the end, or theos, because the sigma is on the end, we use this one. But there are plenty of words where there the sigma is in the middle. Jesus, the name for Jesus, you're going to have yes, which has the first sigma, and sus, the last final sigma has that. And then the capital sigma kind of looks like a, well, it's actually the word, it's the symbol used for sum, like when you add things together. So that's the way I know it from a little bit of math, but there's just kind of looks like a sideways M. So that's your capital sigma. Tau, you know, capital T, lowercase T says T. Upsilon, you know, says U, lowercase U. Also has the capital letter is used as a Y. So just know that. I take that back. We did not do Upsilon. So Upsilon is just, that's what it is. It's the, it looks like a lowercase U. It's called an Upsilon. It says U, just like that. And the capital letter is a Y. Phi, another letter you don't know, another letter we've not done, i.e. Pharisee, friend. And so this looks like the lowercase, looks like the circle with the line through. This is more of a font thing. If you look real close, it doesn't have it totally connected. Some of them don't, some of them do. So just that's a font thing, but it looks like a circle with the line up and down. The capital Phi is definitely all the way through and it's set up higher and full. This says, that's the Phi. Key. Looks like lowercase X with a capital key being an uppercase X. Worth noting here that the key, technically speaking, doesn't say K like kappa. Technically, it's a soft K, as in like K, so like Loch Ness Monster. Most people don't take the time to go K. Technically, that's the way it's supposed to be said. So it should be Christ rather than Christ. You can hear the difference. K, Christ. There you go. That's the key. The psi says ps, And there is your, it looks like a trident, both the upper and lowercase. The uppercase is just more pronounced. And then here is your omega, another word, another letter you don't know, looks like a W. And then the capital omega looks like a horseshoe. And the omega says O. So there's all your letters. And I would recommend learning kind of this way. Learn the alpha, beta, gamma, delta all together. Now, alpha, beta, gamma, delta, or epsilon, do the first five. Alpha, beta, gamma, delta, epsilon. And then these are going to rhyme. Zeta, eta, theta. Learn those together. And then iota, kappa, lambda, mu all go nice and together. And by the way, notice how closely this follows to the English alphabet. It looks like an A, B. Gamma doesn't fit. That's more like a G, but A, B. And then you have the C and the D, E. The zeta, eta, theta are their own thing, but then the I, the K, the L, the M, the N, this tends to follow because ultimately Greek is based on, or English is based on the Greek alphabet. Continuing over, so if you go capital N to mu, and then nu, xi, omicron, you can take those three together, p, rho, sigma, take those three together, tau, upsilon, take those, and then phi, he, psi, omega. There's a little song that has that beat to it in a minute, so that's the way. Just watch that part of the video until you get it down pat. Now, we've already talked about vowels and consonants. Let's finish up here, get towards the end, but looking at letters. It's easy to confuse some Greek letters with English letters, and it's easy to confuse some Greek letters with other Greek letters. This is not exhaustive, but these are the ones that I found most confusing. The eta is not an N. We've established that from the beginning. Here you go again. The eta is not an N. The mu is not a U. They even sound, mu sounds like U. The mu is not a U. The mu says m, and the U says uh. The nu is not a V. And this is probably this one in the row probably get people when they're first starting the most. So be careful. The nu is not a V. The rho is not a P. I'm sure you've already experienced the frustration of that one. The key is not an X. You have a XI, that's the X. So be careful not to do that. And then the omega is not a W. Omega says O. It doesn't say what. There are some Greek letters that look like other Greek letters. The gamma is not a nu. The nu does not have a little line off the bottom like the gamma does. That little bitty line off the bottom makes all the difference, doesn't it? The mu is not an upsilon. Make sure you pay attention to the lines off the bottom and other side. And the sigma is the middle sigma is not an omicron. Make sure again that the little line off the top is there. Oh, it's a sigma. It's not off the top, then it's an omicron. So just be sure. One of the ways to do this is to, when I did this, I spent a lot of time writing out flashcards and writing these letters out. It took about 4 hours really to down pat writing them. And I would pull my flashcard out, say the name, and then I would close my eyes and I would put off the side, and then I would write it until what I had it. That's the way I did it. Whatever study method works for you, you'll find it goes pretty quick. All right, next, let's go ahead and do the accent and breathing marks. I told you I would discuss the letters above and below the words in our last video that we're going to do it here. So here is your verse again, John 1:1, NRK and halagos, logos, kai, halagos, and pros, ton, theon, kai, theos, and halagos. So above these letters, you're going to see a lot of words. You're going to have these little marks. The most common of these are called accent marks. And what they do is they tell you which syllable gets the emphasis. And so if I take this word here, since the RK has the emphasis on the second half, it's RK. It's not RK, it's RK. It's not logos, it's logos. It's not, chi is a single, it doesn't really matter a lot. It's not theon, it's theon. And it's not, again, not logos, it's logos. So there are three kinds of accent marks. For our purposes, they make no difference in meaning. Originally in classical Greek, it was a tonal language. And so if the mark went up, then your tone went up. If the mark went down, your tone went down. If the mark went around this way, then your tone went up and down. So for example, this would be something like logos, because it goes up. Whereas if it goes down, a grave would be ton, going down. And if it was a circumflex, it would go up and down. RK, we don't do that anymore. It's just now about, by this point in Greek history, it was just about telling you which word, which syllable had the right, had the emphasis. But those are the three kinds you'll see. And the one that go up, the one that goes down, and the one that kind of is a tilde or a little, looks like an upside down U or a horseshoe. So those marks are your accent marks. Pay close attention. It lets you know easier to pronounce which emphasis, which syllable gets the emphasis. The other kind of mark you need to note are called breathing marks. And these will always appear at the beginning of words that begin with vowels. So N, meaning N, obviously, starts with a vowel, so it gets a breathing mark. Or K starts with a vowel, it gets a breathing mark. Ha just is a vowel, starts with a vowel, gets a breathing mark. Ain starts with a vowel, gets a breathing mark. So if the breathing mark points to the left, it goes to the left side of the page, that is going to be a smooth breathing mark, and you ignore it. So it's not, it's just N, it's just RK, it's just ain. That's all it is. If, on the other hand, it's open towards the right part of the sentence, it's open, then that's called a rough breathing mark, and you're going to say ha in front of it. So ha logos, okay? There's no, in this particular verse, there's no other rough breathing marks, but there's plenty of Greek words that start with a rough breathing mark, and you'll start with the H sound. This won't occur in the middle of a word. It's just at the beginning of the word. So again, if it goes that way, see here, opening that way, you're going to ignore it. If it opens this way, it's going to be the rough, you're going to say the H sound. Okay. Last couple of things I want to cover are diphthongs, and then one more issue after. Diphthongs are anytime you have two vowels put together, two specific kind of vowels, you can make a combined sound. They are those diphthongs that end in iota or upsilon. And so the alpha iota together make an aisle, an I sound, which is easy to see. Again, think about the English word aisle. So alpha iota are always going to say I, so hence the word chi, right? The epsilon iota is going to say A, which is eight. For example, in English, eight. That's pretty easy. The omicron iota is going to say oi, as in soil. The alpha upsilon is going to say ow, as in sauerkraut. The omicron upsilon is going to say oo, as in soup. And the epsilon upsilon or the eta upsilon is going to say u, as in feud. So learn those. Wouldn't spend too much time worrying about it, because you'll notice them in the grammar. And I'll make sure to point out proper pronunciation of some of these in the early videos. But there's your diphthongs. So then finally, an easy way to remember the alphabet. There's a little silly song. I totally got this from Mounts, his textbook. He has a little CD in the back of the book. This song is on this CD. It's to the tune of Mama's Little Baby Loves Shelton and Bread. I don't know what the song is actually called, but it goes something like this. Forgive my terrible singing voice. It goes. Alpha, beta, gamma, delta, epsilon, zeta, eta, theta, iota, kappa, lambda, mu, nu, xi, omicron, pi, rho, sigma, tau, upsilon, phi, chi, psi, omega. So whether you can sing or not, I recommend learning that song. It's just an easy way to learn the alphabet. And at this point, you know your alphabet and can proceed now to start sounding out words. A fun little exercise is write your own name in Greek. Find words that we haven't studied yet that you just want to look up. Let's take the word right here. You know this, theos, you know that word. What about this one? There's an alpha, there's a gamma, there's an alpha, there's a P, and there's an eta. That's a smooth breathing mark with the emphasis in the middle. So that's going to be agape. There you go. That's agape. You probably know that means love. Hear this word, eta. That's a mu. That's an iota. That's a nu. That's a circumflex accent on the second. So it's going to be the emphasis on the second syllable. This is a rough breathing mark. So that's heimin. Heimin. And we'll get to that word later on when we get there. So anyway, I hope you have found this interesting and helpful. As always, questions, comments, leave them down in the comments below. I'll get to them as we can, and we will see you back next time. We'll get into John chapter 1, verse 2. Many blessings.